This is Whitley Strieber, and this is a Dreamland video presentation. You have reached the edge of the world. Well, today on Dreamland, we have a guest we've never had on Dreamland before, astonishingly. Melinda Leslie is going to be with us. She is a abductee. She is a MyLab experiencer, and she runs one of the most amazing tours on planet Earth in Sedona, Arizona. And we're going to talk about all of that a little bit later. Before we start, I want to talk about two things that aren't related directly to this show that I'm doing. First, I'm at Making Contact, August 18th to the 22nd, and it is virtual. It's held on a virtual stage called The Island, which you download an app for, and it's incredibly cool because you can go all around the island to different panels and discussions. It's amazing. I'm going to be at this with Marshall Summers, Christopher Mellon, Linda Moulton Howe, Mark Sims, Danny Sheehan, Ralph Blumenthal, Lou Elizondo, and Eric Weinstein, among others, if you can believe it. It is going to be really something. How do you get to it? Well, you go to makingcontact.com, and the price for the weekend is $249. But if you enter the promo code WhitleySave100, that's the words Whitley Save and then the number 100 all run together, it becomes $149 for the weekend, which, as you know, as these conferences go, is a great price. And quite frankly, what is going on here is an effort to create a human response to the presence that is here. Will we manage to achieve open contact? Well, there's only one way that's ever going to happen. That's if we do it, we the people. That's why we're doing this, and that's the whole theme of this conference. Now, in September 17th to 19th, I'm going to be at the Conscious Life Expo live at the LA Hilton here in Los Angeles, hopefully, and I'll be telling you more about that later. And now I want to introduce a guest whom I have, as I say, never had on before, Melinda Leslie. An amazing person. Melinda, just let's welcome to Dreamland. And folks, I want you to meet for the first time on Dreamland, Melinda Leslie.
Thank you, Whitley. Thank you so much for having me. I'm so excited to be here, and I'm so grateful.
Well, I am too excited that you are here, and I can't believe that somehow or another we never intersected before, because folks, let me tell you about the first interaction. I've known Melinda for years, too long.
Yeah, probably close to 30, I think.
Close to 30, exactly. Yeah. But something happened at Contact in the Desert in 2016 when we had it was done in Joshua Tree then, before it moved to the hotel. And there was a sky watch led by Melinda Leslie and witnessed by many people, including this guy. Can you tell us a little bit about that sky watch and what happened?
Oh, goodness. I'm trying to think if that was the one where we saw many oval-shaped objects in an 11-minute window. From when the first one was seen, and somebody was recording the whole thing, so that's how we know exactly the amount of time. But from when the first one was seen to the last one, it was about 11 minutes, and there were at least seven of these various objects. So you're talking about those one, right? There's ones that were green, ones that were blue, and as far as glowing, the whole thing green, the whole thing blue, and ones where the whole thing was amber. And those are all very commonly seen in sightings, those colors. And now since doing my tours, I've learned from plasma physicists why we're seeing those colors and the significance of them. But it means you're getting something, very brief explanation, you're getting something bleeding so much energy, such a huge electrical signature, it's ionizing the air around it. And that's called electrical plasma. And the amber is not quite as powered up as the blue. And then the green is even more powered up, you know, more energy to get the green than the blue. And I've learned this from taking both physicists and plasma physicists on my tours I do in Sedona. But it was remarkable. We just had so many sightings in a short period of time. We were on a lookout point overlooking a valley, and they were coming over a hill in the distance and sweeping down over that valley right in front of us. I mean, Whitley, you and I know that that was like, had to have been a deliberate display just for us.
It was the most amazing sighting, group sighting experience I've ever been involved in. I was astonished.
Wow.
It was brain bending. I remember Jimmy Church was there too, and quite a few.
Jimmy was standing right next to me, just, and he immediately, you know, for days went on the air talking about it. You know, he was just, him and Rita were just blown away. Yeah.
Well, right. We were blown away, and people are often blown away in your sighting. On your sighting tours. Now, I want to circle back because, folks, we're going to figure out Melinda Leslie this morning somehow or another. And this is a big, long, incredible story. One of the great stories in the whole contact, close encounter world is Melinda's.
Oh, thank you.
Let's start with where it started in your life. There was an abduction.
Well, it
started, is that where it actually started?
I'm used to telling what I call my origin story. So I'll go for that. So everyone will understand. Abductions started for me in childhood, but I did not know it till 1989. Often people have it happen quite a bit and then have some kind of discovery process. And that's what happened for me. A friend of mine was listening to the radio late one night in late August 1989, and she had an interest in Native American studies, and she worked in a law firm, and someone she knows turned her on to what we now know back then was called Billy Goodman's The Happening. It was a radio show broadcast out of Las Vegas with the host Billy Goodman. You might remember that, Whitley. And at the time, they were doing Native American elders. And all of a sudden, one night, they switch and they have this gentleman on. It turned out to be John Lear, famous UFO researcher and son of the inventor of the Learjet. And he started talking about what we now know as the Bob Lazar story. Initially, Bob didn't come out with his name. And at that point, he had taken John Lear and Gene Huff out into the desert on Highway 375 in Nevada to the backside of Area 51. And Bob had talked all of, you know, and showed them the sightings because he knew the schedule. He knew this. That's one thing that really speaks to his credibility, by the way, is that he definitely knew the schedule of the test flights and when they were happening because he would always take them out there on those nights at those times. And sure enough, they'd see it. And so he knew that and they were having all these sightings. Well, John Lear was going on this program and sharing that and sharing going out there with Bob and Gene and Bob getting picked up by base security and the whole entire, you know, the rather elaborate story involved with all that. And people were calling in to this radio show saying, well, this is Highway 375 and that's BLM land. You know, can we go out there and see this? And my friend said, Melinda, turn this on. This is real interesting. And now at the time, I had only had maybe one previous UFO sighting as a child, and then one in 1987 over the harmonic convergence where I was living in Southern California, but came here to Sedona, Arizona, and had some great sightings at that time over the harmonic convergence. And so that, but so she was with me in 87 for that event and knew that. And she thought I might be interested in this. I didn't have much of an interest, but I turned it on. What was absolutely fascinating, that whole story. And this character that wasn't on yet, but they were talking about, and that character, of course, being Bob Lazar, but he wasn't on there. It was just, initially, it was John Lear, and then a few other researchers that he had taken out there and were also going on it. So, but that, my friend said, everyone's going out there, let's go do this. Let's go out there and see what everybody's seeing. And producer of the show, long story short, rented two buses and everyone could meet up and either you could sign up to go on the bus or follow in your car, meet up at a hotel in Vegas, you know, casino parking lot, and drive the 2.5 hours out to Rachel, Nevada. So we did that. And we drove 5 hours from Southern California, where we were living at the time, and drove to Vegas. And we got out there too late to really follow the buses, but they told everyone the mile marker on Highway 375, which is now what everyone knows as the black mailbox, the road going down to a cattle ranch called Midland Ranch. It's all very famous in ufology lore. But we went out there and had amazing sightings multiple times. We got out there, the two buses were just leaving. They said, we've had a bunch of sightings. We have a bunch of, you know, elderly individuals, and we have a over 2 hour drive back to Vegas. And we're like, oh no, did we miss it? You know, but we stayed out there with about 40 other cars, you know, and there had to have been at least over 50 people for sure. And we had, again, we had amazing sightings and we were so blown away. We did the whole trip 2 weeks later, and then again a month after that. So this was now September and October of 1989, three back-to-back trips out to Area 51, you know, out to Highway 375 in the town of Rachel, and having amazing sightings and sitting out, you know, multiple nights in a row each time. Well, something, Whitley, about having all those sightings was like inserting a key and turning it, because I started to have memories come forward of childhood, you know, childhood, teenage, and young adult abduction accounts. And at first I thought I was completely losing my mind. And I sought the help of a therapist that had been recommended to me that also did regressive hypnosis, but she was a full-fledged doctor of psychology, a PhD psychotherapist, doctor. And I went to her saying, I think I'm losing my mind. And she said, well, let's see.
Are you losing your mind?
She said, well, okay, I'll determine that. I'm the pro here. You know, she said, you know, so, and so she did some, you know, regressions on me. And that, unfortunately, she's passed away. It was the late Dr. Deborah Troncalli. And Deborah worked extensively with Bud Hopkins and John Mack and all the other major abduction researchers, Dave Jacobs, et cetera, and was kind of trained by Bud, if you will, for how to do this with the abductees. And part of everything back when they did the MIT study, and, you know, she was a part of the whole thing. So, but anyway, so I got regressions from her, and lo and behold, you know, I found out I had had experiences. Now, it started with first looking back at some kind of childhood and teenage events. But then all of a sudden I had a current, so in late 89, a series of current new abductions back to back, and even a roommate of mine who witnessed. Whitley, if you want, I can give two quick examples from my childhood, what we called, and then one of the ones in late 89. Would you like me to do that?
Yeah, please do that. That would be great.
Okay. I get asked this a lot on my tours, so I admit this is kind of the part I'm used to saying.
We'll talk about Melinda's tours in a little while.
Well, when I, you know, there's information about me, of course, online and the website and whatnot. And it kind of says, if you ask her nicely about her experiences, she may be willing to talk about it. And I tell you, Whitley, it's tough when I get asked all the time, as I'm sure you're well aware, you know, constantly talking about it. You think it would get easier. Not necessarily, you know,
not necessarily.
It depends on the mood in an evening. But if my client, depending on the clients and their attitude and whether there's children present and the various things that, but I do talk about it if asked. But anyway, so this part I'm about to share, it's the part I'm kind of used to sharing the most. But so when I was having those memories come forward after all those trips out to Area 51, as I said, three back-to-back times having so many sightings, it was like inserting a key and turning, because I started to initially have dreams at night. For instance, when I was 5 years old, my grandmother had a place in Yucca Valley, California, infamous for the famous giant rock and the Integratron and those things for people who are familiar. And now my grandmother wasn't into any of that, but she had a little kind of homestead in the middle of nowhere. And I'm the youngest of five kids. And we'd go out there. And one day I'm put down for a nap at like 5 years old. And one adult stayed behind. I think my aunt, my cousins were maybe out there. So I think it was maybe my aunt. But I was put in to bed for a nap. And everyone else went into town, I think to see a movie. And I always had this memory my whole life, even since five, that little kids came to the bedroom window. Now, my grandmother's place was in the middle of nowhere. Her closest neighbor was about 50 yards away, was an old guy with two mules in his yard. And one of them was named, this was the early 60s. One of them was named Kennedy. So I'm thinking probably the other one was named Eisenhower, but we would go feed Kennedy. Yeah, we'd go feed the donkeys, two donkeys, I should say, not mules, two donkeys, Kennedy and Eisenhower. So, and so we'd go feed Kennedy all the time, apples and carrots and whatnot. And so I was, like I said, put down for a nap. And I always remembered that little kids came to the bedroom window and wanted me to go play with them. And that the adult had fallen asleep on the couch and I snuck out. So this was, you know, during the afternoon, everyone else was in town. The closest neighbor is, like I said, 50 yards away. And the next closest to either of them, you know, was like a mile away. And quite, they're really in the middle of nowhere. And little kids came to the bedroom window and wanted me to go play with them. I snuck out past the sleeping adult and went out and played with these kids. Everyone came home from the movies or whatever they were doing in town. And they said, Melinda, how was your nap? And I said, I went outside and played with little kids. And they said, no, it's like 102 out. And grandma lives in the middle of nowhere. You know, there's no little kids anywhere. And I said, no, I went outside, played with kids. And then they looked to the, you know, the adult who was babysitting me. And they said, what gives? And they said, oh, she was asleep the whole time. Well, so that memory I had. Well, after all those sightings and meeting Dr. Troncalli, she regressed me about that event. But of course, it wasn't little kids at the bedroom window. It was gray aliens and that I had an experience. And I received a little scoop mark on my leg that I have to this day. In fact, in a much later experience, years later, they gave me another scoop mark, which is an indentation scar for those who aren't familiar. Right?
Yeah. Now, the scoop marks are often associated with an implant being embedded in another part of the body. Have you ever had that looked for?
Yeah. When Dr. Roger Lear was alive, he took a whole series of x-rays of me, but nothing came up in those x-rays. And he said, Melinda, I can't do a surgery unless I see it in an x-ray or at least an MRI. And back then, there was no funding or anything, and I didn't have the money to get MRIs done, but nothing came up in the x-rays that he did for me. That was many, many years ago when he was still alive. If he had found something in any of the x-rays, because we x-rayed the spots where I thought it was most likely to have something, but when nothing came up in the x-rays, of course, you know, no surgery was done. But you know, a lot of people find them in Whitley, I know you understand this, and don't necessarily want them removed.
I'm wearing one in my ear right now. Yeah, yeah. And I don't want it removed at all. I use it all the time.
And yes, and back then I would have contributed to the research and had Roger remove it. Probably I had more than one anyway. So, but since nothing came up in the x-rays, obviously that never happened, you know. So I have reason to believe I have them. There's a gentleman who can test you with a couple different pieces of equipment, and both a Gauss meter and a stud finder.
They both work.
Pings me. They both ping me. The T3, we know that in abduction research, that's very common. But the top of the spine, my T3 vertebrae, pings on a Gauss meter and on a stud finder repeatedly and behind this ear. So my ear and there both ping.
One of the implants that Rogers gave me to study at Southwest Research had been emitting a low-level FM signal, but when we put it into X-ray diffraction to see if there was any crystalline structure in it to explain the fact that it could emit this signal, mm-hmm. it disappeared, became X-ray invisible after the first pass of the diffraction machine.
Yeah.
So these things could be there and be X-ray invisible very easily. They can. Well, they do have that ability.
Both a stud finder and, you know, which is going to pick up metal. Now, the gentleman who used both of those said, yeah, you could get a false positive on either one. But with the Gauss meter and a stud finder both pinging, he said, that's not likely that both of them would ping. So, and yes, the top of my spine and behind my ear do ping. But again, nothing's come up in an X-ray, but like you said, and even Roger said that at the time, it just might be, you know, radio opaque, and yet still something there. So there we go. But you know, again, couldn't have a surgery done unless there was pretty hard physical evidence for him to go in.
You wouldn't want the surgery done on the one on your neck anyway, I don't think.
Yeah, or the one behind the ear, maybe. That, you know, I may have, if he had found something in either of those places, but, you know, we also, because I have scoop marks on my shins, so we did the shins, the knees, the feet, you know, everything. But again, nothing was coming up. So
the one on the neck that's in a very important place because it's where the connection between the body and soul starts. Mm-hmm. And it's an important spot. And it's probably the reason that you get so much reaction to your efforts to see UFOs because they can communicate with you very easily mm-hmm. because of that being there. Mm-hmm. In other words, you've been set up.
That's no doubt on that one.
Yeah.
In many
ways.
Okay,
you
guys, that's an abductee joke in a way. You know?
Right, exactly.
Any abductee laughs like, oh, yeah. You know, like,
jokes, we abductees, but we've got a lot of them.
Right. Well, you know, I tell you, you definitely got to have a sense of humor. It's part of the healing process. It's part of coping. It's part of dealing with it. You know, I think anything in life and humor is necessary, obviously, but it sure helps with this. There are many humorous parts to it, you know, trauma and whatnot aside, there's humor there, you know.
And there's some, but you know, at the same time, it can get very serious.
Yeah.
And what is more serious, folks, right now is it's time for our first break for Free Dreamlanders. And we're going to take that break, not with pleasure at all, because we wish we didn't have to do any breaks and we didn't have a free show. I am going to be at Making Contact Virtual on the virtual island, August 18th to 22nd, in order to reduce the price from $249 to $149, input the promo code WhitleySave100. And if you click through from unknowncountry.com, Unknown Country will get a small part of your payment, which we would very much appreciate. So go to the Dreamland show page and click through from there if you wish. Otherwise, go to makingcontact.com. We'll be right back.
Support unknowncountry.com and its great mission to make contact happen. Use our vast archive of interviews, meditations, commentaries, news, and Whitley Strieber audiobooks to expand your mind and your understanding of close encounter. Meet others who have similar interests on our active free message board or in our subscriber comments and Wednesday night chats. There is no other site like Unknown Country in or out of this world. Go to unknowncountry.com and subscribe today.
How curious are you?
How much do you really want to know about the world you live in? There are, for example, very real conspiracies. We're talking about one of them today. And this is a place where if it's real, we're going to talk about it, but not if it's not real. So there's no confusion here. If we're talking conspiracy on Dreamland and on unknowncountry.com, it's because we can prove it, just like we can prove that the Roswell incident has been covered up. We can prove these things. We can prove that the abduction phenomena is in some way very real. We can prove that there are unusual materials in this world because some of them are right here in my possession. So, this is an unusual place. It's a unique place. And above all, it is a great place to explore. Exploring the unknowncountry.com archive is a really extraordinary experience. It's a place where you can regain what we are losing, which is a lost sense of wonder and a willingness and to explore the unknown. We live in a terribly difficult world right now. This place is an oasis of wonder. Join unknowncountry.com today.
Did we misunderstand the teaching of Jesus? Perhaps a long time ago, perhaps almost as soon as he rose from the dead, we mistook him for something that he may not have been. But we do know one thing, he was one of us. His life and his resurrection reveal the power of the good in all of us. And his teaching shows anybody, whether they have religious beliefs or not, how to find that goodness and live it. Get Jesus a New Vision. It's available as an audio book. It is available as a paperback and as a Kindle. Get it today. We're talking to Melinda Leslie. And Melinda, I'm not sure which is the best website for people to reach you. Can you tell us the website?
Yeah, sure. The best way is through the Center for the New Age, which is where I'm sitting right now in my office. And this is where I do tours, and I also do readings from here and classes. I do some classes, readings, and my tours. So the Center for the New Age is, the website is SedonaNewAgeStore.com. But even if you just Google Center for the New Age in Sedona, you'll find it. But again, SedonaNewAgeStore.com. And I should say this, UFOSightingTours.com. So if you go to UFOSightingTours with an S on the end, T-O-U-R-S, .com, you'll go directly to my website.
Okay. Now, tell us a little bit about sighting tours, your sighting tours, because I think you are, I believe you to be the best person in the world in this very odd and field, and it's rare. People work hard to conjure up UFOs, and they sometimes succeed. Some of Stephen Greer's programs succeed. There are other programs that sometimes succeed. How many times have you taken out sighting tours in total to date?
Well, I had a tour last night. And so last night's tour was 1,396.
Now, how many sightings?
So I've done it a few times.
Yeah. How many of those tours have people not seen verifiable UFOs?
Only twice did my clients feel they didn't have a sighting. That's only happened twice. So the other 1,394 tours, my clients always thought they had sightings. It doesn't matter what I think, it's what my clients think, you know, or right. What my clients see. So all the other times my clients would tell you they saw true unknowns, things that they could not identify. And that's even ruling out. And I know, you know, skeptics and debunkers out there have a field day with this stuff. that's ruling out all the known things, you know, like satellites, for sure. That's a big one. Satellites, drones, all about planes, military planes, helicopters, shooting stars. You know, we rule all the known things out, and then we're left with the unknown. So that's my clients feeling like we ruled all those things out to know. And I spend a full half hour with my clients before we even start looking with the night vision goggles, a full half hour covering all those known things and how to identify them. I've had many satellite experts go out with me, and I tell my clients everything I share about satellites I've learned from taking out people who launched them, program them, retrieve them, engineer them, you know, for a living. And so I want to make sure. And whenever I take anyone who works with satellites for a living, I'm like, pounce, you know, pounce, you know, I want to make sure I know what I'm saying, you know, and that we're able to know when we're seeing those things. Occasionally, I have people running satellite apps during the tour. I'm just so busy with my clients. I've learned it's not something I can easily do and be instructing my clients and everything at the same time. But often my clients will bring up satellite apps, and very few things actually come up on the apps, the satellites, you know. We see so many things that don't come up at all, you know. So anyways, but we see real unknowns. And then Whitley, we've seen fully structured craft, you know, like you know, floating above us, full structure, 55 times.
55 times.
Full structure. And we're having sightings every time, but usually they're up too high to make out the shape, you know. So we're seeing lights, but they're craft. They're most of what we're seeing because it's reflecting sunlight, which is the same reason you see satellites. There's no lighting on satellites. The only reason you ever see them is they're reflecting sunlight. So sunlight, we see craft, yeah, reflecting sunlight, but when something stops, turns, changes direction, you know, zigzags. I mean, last night we had a bunch that really zigzagged. It was amazing. And things that fly in formations and, you know, do things that satellites don't do. And, you know, speed up, slow down, power up. We also use lasers, and we flash at them. We get them to flash back. You know, Whitley, before we went to the break, I kind of left people hanging because I said I was going to share two other quick experiences, one of them, yes, from childhood and one
current
one.
So let's go ahead and do that.
Yeah, I just felt like I knew we said that, and then I know we're going to get sidetracked a lot.
Well, that's the whole
nature
of this game.
I said right before I went on with Whitley, we were listing like all the topics we wanted to be sure and cover, and it's like we're going to zigzag a lot today. I think so. Patience,
I think so.
Okay, so going back real quick, just again, out in Yucca Valley, when I was 12 years old, we're staying at the little hotel called the Yucca Inn, and my family were going to go on a day hike to Joshua Tree National Monument, you know, and which is a botanical gardens kind of thing. And again, it was a really, really hot day, and I wasn't feeling well. So I was at 12. I was plenty old enough to be left alone. And they said, well, you can go in the pool at the complex if you start feeling better. They'd packed a picnic lunch, but they left food, you know, took mine out for me. And they said, you know, we'll check on you later. And I said, go have a good time. I just don't feel good at all. And they took off. And I laid down in the hotel room. Back then, there was no such thing as a non-smoking room. So the room stunk like smoke. And there was this really loud wall-mounted air conditioning unit. So I couldn't sleep between those two things. I just kept feeling more nauseous. I decided to go outside and do a little walk to get some fresh air. Walked out in the parking lot. The hotel at the time backed up on just open desert. And I kind of walked down the back street and then came back. And I came in the restroom. Now, at 12 years old, I had a good sense of time. I had laid down but never fell asleep. It was way too noisy and too stuffy in the room. And so I went out, got fresh air, came back because I had to use the restroom. I was in the restroom and everybody comes back. And I go, oh, you decided not to go on your day hike? It was too hot, or you got there and turned around? Because I figured they'd been gone about an hour. And everyone was like, Melinda, what are you talking about? We've been gone all day. We'd been gone 6 hours. And I'm like,
oh my
no.
God.
Yeah. I'm like, no, I couldn't sleep at all. It was too gross in the room. I went out, you know, for fresh air, took a little walk, came back, had to use the restroom. I mean, at the most, I would have said 2 hours tops, you know, not even that, you know. And I'm like, and you guys came right back and they're like, you must have fallen asleep. I said, I wish. I feel like such crap. I wish I could have fallen asleep. And they're like, no, you must have fallen asleep. And so obviously I had significant missing time. They had been gone all day. And they said, oh, you never ate. You must be starving. I said, I thought they were pulling my leg. I'm like, you guys haven't been gone very long. No, I haven't eaten yet. You know, anyway, so obviously I had missing time. Now, again, I had regression from Dr. Troncalli over that. And what had happened is when I went for my walk, I walked out in the desert over a rise and there was a dry creek bed and a landed craft. And I was taken on board and proceeded to get another little scoop mark that I have to this day from that event. And so, yes, there was a landed craft. There were beings around it. I was just compelled to walk towards it. And again, had an experience. And then jumping ahead in late 89, I had two roommates at the time, Scott and Gail. And Scott was out of town on business. We were living in Tustin, California, near where the, for those who, well, it doesn't matter, but Tustin, California, in a two-story townhouse. And Scott was out of town, and Gail and I had a late night discussion. She was separated from her husband and going through a divorce. It's a long story short there. And so she wanted to talk to me about it, going through a lot emotionally. And after our discussion, I went to bed. I was an office manager at the time. I had a project due the next day at work, and I needed to, I told her I want to get to bed at 10, no later than 11. Well, next thing I know, it's midnight, and we were still talking. And I'm like, oh, no, my alarm's going to go off at, you know, 6:30. I'm only going to get six and a half hours of sleep if I fall asleep right away. And I've got a major deadline on a project. So I sat on my bed with the covers up, sat my alarm next to me, and did a quick little breathing meditation exercise, just real quick to calm myself down so I'd fall asleep right away because I was a little agitated after our discussion. So, and I reached to turn off the light and I looked back at the alarm just to absolutely make sure it's set because I got to get up in 6.5 hours, and it was 2.5 hours later. And there's no way I was sitting on my bed for 2.5 hours. I said I'd sit on my bed for 2 minutes, you know. And I was like, oh, my God, what has happened? What has happened? And every time I thought, what has happened? What have you done for 2.5 hours? I kept getting an image of three gray aliens standing next to the bed and one of them holding a device. And I said, this is crazy. You know, back then, I still thought I was losing my mind. You know, this is nuts. And I ended up turning off the light, luckily fell asleep right away. My alarm goes off like 3 hours later, waking the dead, you know. I crawl into work, get through the day, I come home, I'm in the kitchen, and Gail and I are both making dinner. Gail turns to me and says, what happened to you last night? I said, what do you mean, what happened? She goes, well, after our discussion, she couldn't sleep, so she sat up in bed reading. And she said that she kept hearing noises downstairs. So she'd go downstairs and check and nothing going on. She said, she did it 2 or 3 times. And she comes back up and realizes my light is on under my door. We had like Berber carpeting, but this was an old place we were renting. And so it had this big gap under the door from when it was obviously, you know, plusher carpeting at some point. And so she could clearly see my light on. And she knocks on my door, no answer, pounds on my door. She says it's like 3 in the morning. I have a tiny little bedroom. She's pounding on the door, no response. She opens my bedroom door and I'm not there. Whitley, she witnessed I was gone during my missing time.
My word.
But then there's one more thing. So we're going on, we're having dinner. She goes, where did you go? What did you do? She said, I went and I saw your car parked out in the carport. I knew you hadn't driven anywhere. I couldn't find you anywhere in the house. And I'm like, I don't know. So she dropped it for a little bit because she could tell I was agitated. We continued to have dinner and everything. And about an hour later, she says, how do you feel now? I said, I'm fine. Why? She goes, well, there's more. I go, what do you mean there's more? And she said, after she went in my room, she went and sat in her bed, sat up, still reading, hoping she was going to hear me. Now, right outside her room is a landing and then the stairs going down to the front door. And she kept hoping she was going to hear me come in the front door and come upstairs. And she was all ready to go. Is everything okay? What's going on? Where have you been? You know, I'd already, you know, complained about, I was going to say the other word with a B, but she had already complained about having to get to bed right away, you know, and get to sleep right away. And so she said she couldn't figure out where I would have gone at 3 a.m. So she sat in her room and now all of a sudden there's a flash of light in the hallway. She left her door open to the hallway, again, hoping she was going to hear me come upstairs. And there's a flash of light. So she looks expecting to think that maybe I flipped the switch really quick or something in the hallway. And stepping out of the darkness of the hallway into her room is a gray alien. And she's fully conscious, sitting in bed. It comes in her bedroom door, looks right at her, turns, and she'd closed the door to my room after going in. She said, Melinda, it went through your door, your closed door like a knife through butter.
So she
went in my room while I was gone, you know, witnessed my missing time, and then fully conscious saw a gray come in her room, look at her. And I later, you know, got regress and stuff about that experience, because at that point, when my roommate witnessed part of my experience, I'm like, okay, I can't deny this anymore. You know, this
right.
is absolutely
no, of course
going
not.
On.
I mean, you've got, this is the, such the incredibly fascinating thing about you is you have things like a witnessed close encounter like that, which is very rare. You have an astonishing ability to enable other people to see UFOs. I mean, you've really got something going, Melinda, let's face it.
Yeah. Well, Whitley, so do you.
Well, you know, that's true. This is the podcast for close encounter witnesses and people who are interested, because we do this here.
Yes.
This is what we do.
Yes, that's right.
We're in
that's
contact.
Right. And Whitley, you just said it. It's what you and I do. It's
right.
It's our path. It's our life path. It's our calling. It's why we had experiences. You know, to go from having experiences to helping people with experiences to educating the public in a mass way. I mean, clearly this, you know, your path with your experiences and then your books and now the show. I mean, you know, Whitley, it's our path. It's what we're supposed to do. You know, abductees often feel like they're supposed to have a mission, and some of them don't know what that is or don't know if they're ever doing it. I think in yours and my case, Travis's case, Kathleen Martin's case. I mean, I could go on and on. I think there's all,
there
you know,
are many.
Debbie Jordan's case. You know, there's so many of us that
Debbie's,
we're going, we
Carrie
know what
Lovelace.
Our mission is, you know?
Yeah. We know. Well, listen, it's a good time. I think I'm going to take a little break and for our free Dreamlanders again. And then after that, we're going to talk about contactee rights, which is a big issue. And then later in the show, when we move on to our subscriber area only, we'll be talking about military abductions, which Melinda is also an expert on. Okay, so free Dreamlanders, listen up to these commercials. But before you do so, I will be at Making Contact August 18 to 22nd. If you go to makingcontact.com, you can get a ticket. I'm going to be there with quite a few other extraordinary guests, Chris Mellon, Linda Moulton Howe, Mark Sims, Danny Sheehan, Ralph Blumenthal from the New York Times, and the recent book about Dr. John Mack. Lou Elizondo is going to be there, Eric Weinstein, Marshall Summers, and many others. It's going to be an attempt to begin the process of the human side of contact in an organized way, because this is not going to come to us through the government. It's not going to happen that way. It has to happen from us. We have to be the ones who start making it known to these other presences that we are ready to have more open contact with them. That's what it's about. Makingcontact.com.
And Whitley, when's that event online?
August 18 to 22.
All right.
And it is...
I'll be there online. I'm not speaking or anything, but I'll be there to listen to you guys. Absolutely.
Oh, good.
That
well,
sounds
thank
remarkable.
You.
That's a hell of a lineup. Wow. What a lineup.
Yeah, it's a big...
it's like everybody who's, got something going on in the field right now. That's very important.
I think it's the best lineup that's ever been assembled for something like this.
Yeah.
Because it's so many divergent opinions. I mean, Lou... Chris, Alec, me, Linda, all of these people are going to have different ideas. And that's what's so valuable now. We're exploring now, and different ideas are very important. Anyway, you can click through from Dreamland, or you can go directly to makingcontact.com to sign up. And don't forget Whitley Save 100.
And there's two events I'm attending. Unfortunately, I'm not a speaker at either one, but I'll have an exhibit table with information about my
tours. Tell us about these.
One is MUFON International, the MUFON International Symposium in Las Vegas, which is the last weekend in August. And then the other one is just literally 2 weeks after that is the International UFO Congress in Laughlin. I mean, I'm sorry. Not, I'm sorry. I'm sorry.
No, it's not in Laughlin.
yeah, that's right. It's right. It's in Phoenix. It's
Phoenix,
in Phoenix.
Right.
Yeah, it's at the Sheraton in downtown Phoenix. I'm so used to saying, because for years it was in Laughlin, so it automatically rolled off my tongue. But no, the International UFO Congress in Phoenix, which is, I think it starts the 8th of September. I'm pretty sure that's correct. It's that... second weekend, basically, in September. It's about 4 days long, starting the 8th, and then MUFON. So I'll have an exhibit table of both of those.
Okay, and to reach Melinda, there are a number of ways to do it. You can click through on any one of her websites on unknowncountry.com. You can go to
UFO Sighting Tours is probably just the easiest way.
Okay, UFO Sighting Tours, then that's what we're going to say. UFO Sighting Tours.com.
Yeah, you got it.
And I'm going to definitely be out there in Sedona soon.
I would love to take you, Whitley.
I think it would be a blast
to take you out.
And folks, I will let you know when I'm scheduled to be going with Melinda, and a bunch of us can probably go together on one or two nights, and it'll be a lot of fun.
And the visitors, the guys, better show up with structured craft when Whitley comes. That's all I can say, you guys. We better get structured craft.
Well, I want to warn you, they are notorious for not showing up when I come.
always have signs, so we'll see them. But whether
we'll
they'll
see
come
something,
down
but I warn
low
you,
enough for us, we'll see.
They have a sense of humor, too. And, they love jokes and pranks. And one of the jokes I'm getting kind of tired of is that. So hopefully they won't do that anymore.
Well, luckily they don't pull that on me. I always say if we didn't have sightings, I'd go broke in a hurry.
Yeah. No,
luckily we have them. I have a money back guarantee, so it's a good thing we see them.
That implant in the back of your neck is what connects you to them. And you're supposed to be doing this. This is your work. And I know a lot about it, these things, believe me.
Yeah.
We're not going to take a break because we've already taken the break. So let's just go right on. And we're going to talk now about, we're going to move into contactee rights for the next few minutes. And I want, Melinda's very concerned about this. And this is something I have done a blog about on Whitley's journal on unknowncountry.com. And I'll just begin by saying my concern is this. When I saw that what had been published by the government was something called the UAP threat assessment, I thought to myself, what happens if they decide this is a threat? What happens to those of us who are in contact? To Melinda, who is definitely in contact. To me, I'm in contact. And to many other people, do we become... somehow connected with an enemy? What? So I want your thoughts about you contactee rights.
Well, I was concerned and looking at from so many different angles, and Whitley and you and I had talked about this quite a bit on the phone. But I, so for the audience, I, not only about what you were saying, what if they sell this as a threat? And yes, I understand now, and because a lot of people will jump on us about that, that because I get it when I've talked about it, which is, I understand that they're talking about a threat to military airspace so far. They're talking about incursions into military airspace by sightings, as far as the UAP task force and the report goes and the current attention on from that angle. And I get that. So they're not necessarily stating it's a threat to mankind or to people, you know, kind of thing. But there's a tricky kind of gray area here where they say that and put it as a threat, but the public may not distinguish, because I'm already getting that from clients and people I talk to, they're not always distinguishing between that overall view of saying a possible threat to military airspace and saying a larger threat. And so that's not always distinguished. So even though they may not mean it that way in what they're saying, it is some at times being perceived that they're saying there's a bigger threat. Regardless, they're selling it to the public this way. And I also understand, and I'm sure you do too, Whitley, why they're having to sell it to the public that way is because they're selling it to the Senate and Congress to get them to take it seriously and to go towards congressional hearings and everything. So part of me wants to say, well, I certainly support that. But at the same time, I get concerned, and you just said it, Whitley, how is this going to reflect on people with contact? And I'm going to use contact as the big umbrella as far as like the contact modalities. And certainly, you know, abductees, experiencers, contactees, and military and witnesses, sighting witnesses, all fall under that category by that big umbrella. So, but I started to go, well, how will this reflect on us? Are we perceived ever as part of that threat? And if it is a threat and it's involved with us, are we perceived as having either some reason in that, and or we might be perceived as the scapegoats in some way? You know, all these things came up for me and other experiencers and contactees that I've spoken to, as well as I also realize there's a lot of media attention right now. And I know Whitley, you and I talked about this quite a bit. And Whitley and I are both concerned that the media attention, I'll let you speak to it here, but it is going to draw attention to us. Many people know out there that I talked to Jim Samivan, the director to the Stars Academy, and he has said to me all along, expect some media attention. And Whitley's already getting it. I'm getting a little. And that, as this disclosure process rolls forward, and it is rolling forward, I know everyone feels that the 9-page report was a setback, but it repositioned the government and their position on the subject. And it is, in fact, you know, moving forward. More is due to come. It was a preliminary report. And Congress has been out, and when they come back in early September from their recess, they're going to be addressing this. Now, granted, there's many other issues on the table. So even the key researchers in the field are saying it's pushed back a little bit because of other issues they're dealing with, but it's not gone away. Everyone who's talking to anyone involved with the Senate and Congress and White House connections, I'll say, yes, it's moving forward. So I get concerned where do contactees fit in? First off, they are not part of that discussion right now. And because they're not part of that discussion, we could very likely get additional media attention. And I also got concerned about what are the public abductees, contactees saying about the subject, and are they presenting it with the facts and in the best light? Now, I would never tell anyone not to be public and not to talk by any means. I encourage everyone, but I think we can do so in a very smart, constructive way. So I got concerned about these things enough that, thank God, I'm very good friends with attorney Daniel Sheehan. And I contacted Dan Sheehan, and who I talked to quite often. And I said, Dan, I have these concerns. Who else am I going to go to but you for some advice on what we should do? Can we maybe get a team of legal individuals together to represent contactees, abductees, should they come under any harassment or ridicule? You know, is this going to spin good for us? Is it going to spin negative? We need to be proactive, et cetera. And it's kind of a lesson, Whitley, and be careful what you ask for, because it quickly became much of it was, which is wonderful, that it quickly became the Danny Sheehan thing. And he said, well, he started up this new learning educational outreach institute called the New Paradigm Institute. Right. It even has a full building and complex for it and courses going on there. And it's kind of a long story. But he said, let's take it under the umbrella of the New Paradigm Institute and maybe kind of roll what he already does. For instance, his representing Lou Elizondo in whistleblowers and protecting them as well, and military witnesses, and kind of take it into one umbrella of witness and contact rights. And anyway, so we talked about it, and we're moving forward with this. So I'm kind of jumping the gun a little bit here to say Whitley and I had a conversation. Whitley had dinner with Dan Sheehan where this same stuff came up, and anyway, so it's led to. And then I talked to Terry Lovelace, who very much wants to be involved. So as of right now, Dan Sheehan, myself, Whitley, Terry Lovelace are on board, and I'm talking to a few other people now until there's kind of an official rollout of this. But and Whitley, I don't know if I told you this before on the phone. I have a working title, just maybe I did.
No, you didn't actually.
Yeah, so that I've been referring to it as the CRC. You know, everything's got acronyms, right? You know, yeah. And ways to remember them. And I'm thinking the CRC, Contact Rights Coalition, is just my working title. Now, when
that's
we get
a great
every
title, I thank have to you, say it you. Should be the title.
Oh, thank you. I appreciate that. Well, when we get together and we have our first Zoom board meeting, there's about at least three or four other key individuals, another lawyer, because I do want a team of lawyers. So, and Terry Lovelace came on board right away. And there's another lawyer I want to ask. And as well as Dan, obviously, who's already involved. And then there's a couple leading abduction researchers, abduction research and support group leaders, kind of. So, you know, I until I talk to them, I'm not mentioning names now, but I have a couple people on a list that I'm going to talk to. And at one point, we'll have a Zoom call, you know, and officially right. kick off. But
and we'll move this forward.
Yeah.
So that the presence of these people isn't simply overlooked, that we don't get steamrolled or worse, grouped into some kind of thing that involves suggests that we've been abducted by evil aliens or whatever the
yeah.
heck they may come up with. Melinda, we have reached the end of the first hour of the show.
Gosh, that went flying by. My goodness.
Yeah, it sure did, didn't it? And we are going to go on now to the last half hour, during which folks time we're going to talk about the military connection to all of this, which Melinda is one of the leading experts in the world on. And so before we go, Melinda's website is UFOSightingTours.com. You can go on a sighting tour with her in Sedona. I'm going to try to do that in September or October. And we will let you know before it happens. And you should get involved with Melinda. Melinda, before we go, do you have a pair of those wonderful
night vision
glasses?
Sure. Yeah, these are PVS-7 Generation 3 military night vision goggles. They increase the amount of light you see by about 50,000 times. And so when we go out, first off, I always tell everyone, you're going to see like 50,000 times more stars than you can see with your naked eye. And then we have, we see things that stop, turn, change direction, fly in formations, you name it. I mean, last night we had a great, what I call double, two things next to each other that, now you guys, this is, I'll explain something. First off, they don't launch satellites two together. I've asked every satellite expert. There aren't two moving together. But additionally, these two were right next to each other. And occasionally one crossed the other one and was like in front. And then the one in the back would speed up, cross the other one. And then the one in back would speed up, cross the other one. And then that, so they occasionally were doing this. Well, obviously ruling out anything a satellite could ever do. So they were switching positions like that in the sky. It was remarkable. I had seen that before on my tour, but not in a very long time. And I told the clients last night how rare that was, how lucky they were to see that. Because people don't get that if we're seeing something rare that I know, I hadn't seen in 100 tours, you know. But anyways, it was very, very rare. So, but these are the night vision that we use. And then we also use high-powered laser pointers, 500 milliwatt green laser pointers, and we point at stuff, and we also flash at them, and we get them to flash back. Now, I know about not lasering at planes. I spend 15 minutes just on laser safety, but we do flash at these objects, and we get them to flash back at us. So we are having, we're making contact. They're responding to us.
That's the bottom line: making contact and getting response. Melinda Leslie, in the front line, don't miss her work. And you can meet her at the MUFON convention coming up in Las Vegas and at the one in
International UFO Congress
in Phoenix. Yes. And so, Melinda, thank you so much for being with us. And subscribers, we're just going to keep on keeping on. Free Dreamlanders, why don't you become a subscriber and stay with us, because this is a real thing and it's happening and it's quite extraordinary. And this is the one place in the world where there's an intersection between an active close encounter witness, the visitors, and all of you. Thank you for being with us.
You've been listening to Dreamland. Be sure to tune in again next week. Dreamland is brought to you by unknowncountry.com and its family of subscribers. Our theme music is The O of Pleasure by Ray Lynch. Unknown Country was founded by Ann Strieber. Our news editor is Matthew Frizzell. Our coordinator is Amy Safrankova. Whitley Strieber is your Dreamland host. And I'm your announcer, Ted Alexander.